Hi, this is the UK desk for Arts Express, and my name is Brett Gregory. The French Marxist philosopher Louis Althusser outlines for us how our values, desires, attitudes and tastes are shaped by wider capitalist consumer society and culture on a daily basis. He calls this network of influence the ideological state apparatus, and it includes the soft power of, for instance, the media, education, religion, and the family. In turn, Althusser also identifies how this societal framework of influence is enforced by the repressive state apparatus. That is to say, the hard power of, for example, the military, the police, the judiciary, and the prison system. On this evening's show, we're going to be discussing a 2022 independent documentary called Theatres of War: How the Pentagon and the CIA Took Hollywood, an incendiary expose which reveals how Althusser's ideas have been combined to produce propagandist entertainment products like Paramount Pictures' Top Gun Maverick, Amazon Prime's Jack Ryan series, and Activision's Call of Duty. But first, let's listen to the trailer.
So, say you're a producer and you want to make a war film.
You would walk into the entertainment liaison office in downtown Los Angeles.
You say, I want to film at an Air Force base, or I want an aircraft carrier, or I want some Black Hawk helicopters, or whatever it is.
And they would tell you straight away, give us your entire script.
We've worked with Mr. Bay here since Armageddon, if I'm not mistaken, and hope to do more of the same.
I've got a direct line to the Pentagon.
Some people probably would say, well, yeah, I've heard of this, like the Top Gun, maybe Black Hawk Down, maybe some of the Marvel series.
But what they don't know is how systematic this has been and how huge this operation has been.
You can call it censorship, you can call it propaganda. It's all of these things.
Now these freedom of information requests that have been successful allow us to actually look at that list, and it's stunning.
What we've found is that thousands upon thousands upon thousands of products have been affected and are often rewritten at script level by the national security state in the United States. Do normal people know about that? No, of course they don't.
Hi, Brett. My name is Matt Alford. I teach at the University of Bath in the UK, and I specialise in the politicisation of media, especially film, and particularly as it relates to British and American foreign policies.
Nice one, Matt. So please tell us, as ordinary citizens and consumers, what are we up against?
The Department of Defence has got a budget of $800 billion. It's an obscene amount of money to waste. And, you know, there have been all these stories for decades about, you know, the Pentagon spending $640 on a toilet seat and $1,000 on a nacho cheese warmer and things like that. It's a hugely wasteful organization. Not that it's just wasteful and splurging money around, but actually that it really quite actively, really desperately needs to spend a lot of money on PR. And that's not just to attract personnel. But I think that it needs to con the whole world and the American public, of course, most importantly, into thinking that the American national security state is a force for global stability. And it isn't. It just isn't. It's hardly ever is. The United States is very commonly a destabilizing force in many conflicts.
And what would motivate a powerful governmental entity like the Department of Defense to carry out such a sustained PR assault on us? Haven't they got actual wars to fight and real spies to catch?
I think this need for PR was perhaps most clear, though, in the 1990s, after the Soviet Union collapsed. The whole national security state started pouring money into PR, because at that point there was even less rationale for these heavily state-subsidized, taxpayer-subsidized systems of domination to exist, because there was no enemy. It seems a little bit different now because we're in a multipolar world and have been since 2012, maybe 2017, say. But in the 1990s, there was a real opportunity to have developed and forged peaceful alternatives. I mean, there still is, but it was extremely clear at that point. And I always think it's such a great tragedy. And it's, looking at international relations over the past 30 years has just been like watching a slow motion car crash.
And what motivated you personally to pursue this research topic, to co-author your 2017 book, National Security Cinema, with Tom Secker, and to co-produce Roger Stahl's Theatres of War documentary?
About 20 years ago, I began a lengthy private correspondence with Noam Chomsky, the world's most celebrated anarchist and philosopher. So it was really that experience which drove my research. But that said, there were definitely some politically distinct films around that time, right at the start of my research process. So, for example, Behind Enemy Lines, which was set in Bosnia, Munich, which was about Israel-Palestine, and Hotel Rwanda. And these were all received as moderate, uncontroversial mainstream movies. It was only really when I took a more forensic look at them that I could see that they were actually consistent with much more dubious government policies. And they actually had imperialist ideas quite subtly baked into them. So take an example like Three Kings, this anti-war comedy set in Iraq. It starred Mark Wahlberg, George Clooney. Really good movie. But as good as it was, the underlying message of the film was that the United States had been morally inconsistent in the first Gulf War of 1991. And by implication, this left open the idea that a full-scale American invasion or allied invasion that advanced all the way to Baghdad would have been better than what they actually did in the real world. And so that meant that when the film's director met George W. Bush in 1999, way before 9/11, and he said to Bush, look, my film is going to challenge your father's legacy on Iraq. A young George W. Bush was able to shoot back. Well, I'm going to have to finish the job then, aren't I?
Leni Riefenstahl's 1935 documentary, The Triumph of the Will, is often cited as fetishizing Nazism. Is Hollywood fetishizing US cultural imperialism?
In 100 years' time, I doubt that cultural historians will be discussing Triumph of the Will in the same breath as Transformers 12. I mean, the Nazis were systematically and deliberately glorifying a particular man, a totalitarian system. So I do think there is a bit of a difference there. To be fair, though, Top Gun 2 really does have stronger echoes of genuine fascism, I'd say. In my country, the two most well-known film journalists are Mark Kermode and Simon Mayo. Now, they talked about Top Gun 2 and they loved it. And in fact, they scornfully dismissed any political concerns about it. And they said, it's a fictional country in a fictional story, and it doesn't matter. It's a cartoon. It exists in a cartoony world. And then they put on these sort of silly voices to mock people like me who read the film politically. I think it's legitimate to enjoy a film on its own merits, but I don't think it's good to ignore constantly the systematic application of military PR across thousands of film and TV products. And also, I think particularly in the case of Top Gun 2, I mean, state involvement in that film, it was so in your face. I think that it's kind of weird to ignore or dismiss it.
Surely, if the military are at it, then so also are, for example, the police. I mean, people love their crime dramas.
Absolutely, Brett. Yeah, I completely agree. I think it's reasonable to include the FBI and major police forces like the LAPD and the NYPD in our definition of a securitized state. If we include the police, the numbers of productions supported by the security state does zip up a little bit, and it takes us well past 10,000.
Is it just movies and TV shows? What about video games which are played for hours on end by teenagers in the supposed safety and security of their bedrooms?
Yeah, there are other entertainment products targeted and integrated into the national security state. There is reliable evidence to indicate that the US and UK militaries have supported. So Doom, for example, America's Army was the most downloaded game for a long time in the early 2000s. Rainbow Six, Homefront, Call of Duty, Medal of Honor. There was a game called Mercenaries 2, World in Flames, which requires the gamer to take part in an invasion of Venezuela because this like Hugo Chavez socialist type leader has used nuclear weapons on the Allies. Now, the company that made that had previously developed training aids for the US Army, but claims it didn't cooperate with the government on that particular product. you know, that kind of idea, Venezuela nuking someone, or even having nuclear weapons, is just ridiculous. And it's actually a plot device that was used in the Amazon Prime show, Jack Ryan, that series, hugely popular series. Insane threat inflation.
But isn't it just entertainment? Aren't we all grown adults free to make up our own minds? Or does history tell us different?
Entertainment can really exert a pivotal impact on society. There's a historian called John Hope Franklin, and he said that without Birth of a Nation from 1915, the explicitly racist movie, he said that without that film, the Ku Klux Klan would not have been reborn. If we talk about the US military in particular, I'd say that if these systems weren't in place, I'd say that within a few years, I think the US would probably lose all legitimacy and wouldn't be able to use its force overseas, which is not far off really what happened for a few years in the immediate aftermath of the Vietnam War.
Surely the US is not the only guilty nation. Surely the UK, for instance, also has its fat fingers stuck in such political pies.
Well, I have looked at other national cinematic systems a little bit. And in the UK, the Ministry of Defence, we now know, has worked on hundreds of entertainment productions, including films like Kingsmen, Kick-Ass, various James Bond movies. And we are examining the British case now systematically, which is being led by a PhD researcher. What I'd say, though, is that while it is obviously a good idea to pick apart and generally oppose all propaganda, I mean, by any measure, and that's military size, film industry size, foreign policy ambitions, global cultural influence. I mean, the United States is just dwarfs everybody.
So how can concerned citizens and their families actually watch your documentary, Theatres of War?
Well, contact me on Facebook or on YouTube. I'm on Dr. Matt Alford, War, Laughs and Lies. That's if you've got any problems trying to acquire the film. And if you're a student, you should be able to find it for free through your library on the system called Canopy.
Great stuff, Matt. Powerful subject matter. Let's hope people will now think twice about what they pay to entertain themselves.
Thanks very much, Brett. Great talking to you.
This has been the UK Desk for Arts Express with Dr. Matthew Alford from the University of Bath. And I've been Brett Gregory. Cheers.